So we're going to go straight ahead and try to discuss everything about cardiac electrophysiology that was covered in 2 years of fellowship. We'll try to do it in 20 minutes. You think we can do it? Very good. All right, so I have no relevant disclosures for this presentation. And just to introduce you, I mean, cardiac electrophysiology has been around in the world of cardiology for some time, but it's fairly novel in the Caribbean. So far, there are only one, two, three countries that are providing this service. And it's essentially the science of finding, diagnosing, and treating diseases related to the electrical system of the heart. And if you were to imagine the heart as a house, there are components that are very similar. There are rooms, which are your chambers. There are doors, which are the valves. There is a plumbing system, which is, you know, where you put stents. And then there's the electrical system and many more complex things. The treatment of heart rhythm disorders or the electrical issues of the heart involve catheter ablation. And we can use two main energy sources for this: cryo, which is cold therapy, and then radio frequency, which utilizes heat. And of course, diseases related to the conduction system of the heart can also be managed by implantable devices. And that will be the second part of the talk today. So the common pathologies that we see, and you would have all heard about atrial fibrillation, atrial flutter, atrial tachycardia, AV node reentrant tachycardia, Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. Anybody ever heard about that? One of the commonest things you discuss in medical school, right? So that's part of the accessory pathways, and those accessory pathways could conduct antegradely from atrium to ventricle, or retrogradely from ventricle to atrium. And of course, the dreaded ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, which constitutes the concept of sudden cardiac death, right? Those conditions that are treatable by devices, of course, include your heart blocks, which are your first, your second degree, third degree, etc., which are used pacemakers. And of course, for ventricular fibrillation, ventricular tachycardias, you can use your intracardiac defibrillators. Whether as prevention or after the fact, they still work. And of course, in patients with specific types of heart failure, devices can be implanted that improves the quality of life and the length of life. So just as a reminder, this is the conduction system of the heart. We are all born with our own natural pacemaker called the sinoatrial node. And from there, impulses travel to the atrioventricular node via conduction or connections, the anterior, middle, and posterior internodal tracts. They also move from right atrium to left atrium through the Bachman's bundle, as well as some connection between the coronary sinus. Clear so far? Okay, and when it gets down to the AV node, then it goes down his bundle and then disperses into left and right. You would have seen an ECG like this at some point in your training. Notice the shortened PR interval and the delta wave, which makes it a classic diagnosis of Wolff-Parkinson-White. Excellent. So these are all patients of mine over the years that we've accumulated interesting stuff. This is fluoroscopic anatomy. Okay, so this is a catheter coming up through the groin, aorta, on the arch, aortic valve, left ventricle, curves up to catch the atrium. This one, these three are coming up through the groin on the right side, through the vein. This one is positioned in the right atrium, this one across the bundle of His, and this one in the coronary sinus. And these are used to guide you to locate the position of the abnormal conduction or the accessory pathway. Once they're located, then this big one, which is the more expensive one, you use that to deliver your radio frequency ablation and basically get rid of it. This is one of the very few things in medicine that you could actually cure, not just control, right? So this is one of the things I love about this science. It offers an opportunity to cure a condition rather than just control it lifelong. So this is what I see in the lab, the electrophysiology lab. It's a little bit different from your standard 12-lead ECG because this is the electrical activity inside the heart, not on the surface. This is your surface representation. Notice the delta wave here, and during ablation, it disappears, right? So this is one of those where we were able to capture the position of cure. And of course, this patient no longer needs to take their amiodarone or whatever else they were taking. If you've worked in an emergency room at any point in your life, even as a student, you've rotated, you must have seen something like this at some point. This is your narrow, complex, fast, or tachycardia. And you look closely, you can see this rabbit ears. This represents a retrograde P wave. It's going down to the atrium and then comes back up quickly into the, it goes down to the ventricle and comes back up quickly into the atrium, and there you have an activity recorded even before the ventricle repolarizes. Right, so it must be using some fast pathway of getting back up into the atrium. It's usually the node is the one that conducts that fast. So that's a typical example of your AV node reentrant tachycardia. And of course, there's an algorithm that is already established how to manage these patients. They come in with hemodynamically stable, usually regular narrow complex QRS. The things that you're taught, the vagal maneuvers, your carotid sinus massages, IV adenosine, sometimes it works. When it doesn't work, there are other measures that you can take. But a definitive treatment for all of these tachycardias basically is to take the patients into the electrophysiology lab and to find the source of the problem, the abnormal electrical conductions, and zap it. You've seen this? Any experience in emergency room, you would see this. This is actually taken, you know, one day about 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. 20-odd-year-old gentleman coming in, palpitation, second or third episode, and we see this heart rate going up to 190. We gave some adenosine because we think it might have been AV node reentrant tachycardia. It didn't convert to normal sinus rhythm. What it did do is slow down the conduction down the AV node and allowed us to see the flutter waves. So it wasn't therapeutic, but it helped us to diagnose. Right. A little bit later, patient basically stabilized into a 3-to-1 atrial flutter. And 2 days later, when we took him to the lab, he was in a 2-to-1. How do we know it's 2-to-1? Well, these signals here are in the coronary sinus. You see CS910, CS12. So in the coronary sinus, you know, remember the coronary sinus runs in the atrioventricular groove. So that gives you an accurate measurement of what's happening in both the atrium and the ventricle. So you can see spike, 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 spike. 4 compared to 2 QRS complexes in the surface. There's 4-to-2 or 2-to-1, right? So there's a clear case of 2-to-1. And during ablation, which is represented by this blue, we converted to 1-to-1. Now you could actually see clear PR interval, QRS complex. So it works. The actual pathophysiologic mechanism involves this area right here, the cavo tricuspid isthmus. So you see there's these squiggly lines. That area is usually not supposed to conduct, but in patients with atrial fibrillation, it actually allows bidirectional conduction from lateral to medial as well as medial to lateral. So the trick is put your catheters up through the inferior vena cava and find the spot and zap it so that there's no more conduction across the zone, and that will convert. The treatment for atrial flutter is very similar to atrial fibrillation, and the radiofrequency ablation or ablation therapy is superior in all studies when compared to medical therapy. And so that's a class one indication for EP study with ablation. Of course, you have to do very similar management for some time for patients with AFib and aflutter, but the results with atrial flutter are much better with ablation than in fibrillation. And speaking of atrial fibrillation, this is the one that is, you know, everybody is aware of, and is as patients get older, you have a lot more incidence of atrial fibrillation, whether it's paroxysmal, chronic, or persistent. this is how what we really have to do. It's a much more complex procedure where you have to do transseptal puncture and go to the left atrium. This is actually a 3D rendering of the left atrium where you could see your pulmonary veins, right and left upper and lower pulmonary veins. Your ablation strategy really is to encircle these veins with burns so that the abnormal impulses do not escape the pulmonary veins and cause atrial fibrillation. You have to do it all over all four pulmonary veins. And procedure usually lasts about 4 hours to 5 hours, but a newer technique using cryotherapy has dropped that to about half. This again is a 3D rendering of a ventricle, and this is a scar. Conducting tissue, depending on the health and the level of fibrosis, ischemia, etc., we have different voltages that can be mapped to that area. And knowing that, you're able to identify where scar area is, and therefore you can ablate there, because those are usually the substrate for ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation. So we know all of this. I've probably put some of you to sleep already. But what is our regional experience? Well, this is a retrospective analysis from a single team over the last 2 years. What is nice about it, it spans three different CARICOM territories, Trinidad, Guyana, Jamaica, and we were able to look at 101 patients over this period. The patients had essentially normal ejection fractions. More than half were female. Half of these patients, well, the majority of these patients had were in their middle age. And you can tell by the ethnic spread, this probably Trinidad had a lot of patients in this cohort. So there are just over a third Afro-Caribbean and just over a third of East Indian Caribbean. About 20% or just over 20% of patients were actually diabetic, and we can, if you have some time in a discussion, look at a link between diabetes and arrhythmias. And hypertension was much more prevalent. And surprisingly, only 5% of these patients had previous myocardial infarction. In keeping with worldwide statistics, AV node reentrant tachycardia was the majority of what we saw, representing over 50% of all cases. Accessory pathway represented about 15%, flutter fibrillation about 10%, and atrial tachycardia about 7%. So the top four essentially took care of 80%+ of your pathology. And this is what we represented worldwide. We had just over 3/4 patients had ablation therapy. There was one atrial flutter recurrence. We ablated successfully the right-sided dependent atrial flutter, but there's a recurrence that happened on the left side, which has to be treated mainly like atrial fibrillation. And as happens often, patients with Wolff-Parkinson-White have more than one accessory pathways, and they're located in different positions. Some are much riskier, and in this patient, while we were able to ablate the right lateral pathway, there was one, at least one other, which is very close to the AV node, and we did not want to take the risk of having to put a pacemaker in this patient. So we referred them to another center that could actually do 3D mapping and use cryotherapy, which is much safer. We had zero deaths within 30 days, no need for blood transfusion. One case developed pericarditis before discharge, no pericardial tamponade, and no infections. Infection rates are not highly recognized around the world anyway, because it's just a puncture wound in the groin. So that's been our regional experience. We've shown that it can be safe, it can be successful, and the prevalence of disease is fairly similar to what is expected worldwide. So we're gonna switch a little bit from the arrhythmia side of things and move into the device. Does this happen to, are there any non-Jamaicans here? I know Ashanti is. Yeah, does this happen to you? Yes. I it happens to me all the time. And I say, no, sir. Well, this is our Jamaican team here that did the first ablations at Partners Interventional. This is, as you can recognize, my friend, Dr. Elliott. This is Jason from Guyana. We actually had a proctor come in from Costa Rica. So we had put together a very experienced international team to be able to get this done. And this is a team that is mobile on very short notice, and we could actually move around to get patients taken care of. So why we're moving to heart failure now? Why is it that heart failure is such a big topic? Well, this is UK statistic. Almost 10% of patients admitted with an acute heart failure have an in-hospital death. That's 1 in 10. There's a one-year mortality of 27%, 1 in 4. 5% of emergency admissions to all hospitals are for heart failure, and they account for 20% of all readmissions. And if you imagine that US Medicare statistics says that heart failure admission costs $6,000 per day when it's done properly, you could imagine how much of a healthcare and public health burden this is. And 10% of population over the age of 75 have heart failure. It's a big problem. Can you imagine if there was an infection, for example, that had this kind of statistics? The whole world would be in chaos and uproar. So devices that we use to treat heart failure, especially advanced heart failure, or the ventricular assist device, these are mainly in the domain of the cardiac surgeon. So I really don't get involved in that. What we do get involved in are things like the defibrillators and cardiac resynchronization. Cardiac resynchronization therapy can be available with defibrillator or with just pacing, depends on specific indications and patient wish. In order to understand exactly the use of this defibrillators, one needs to understand the concept between primary prevention and secondary prevention. Primary prevention is when you identify a high-risk patient, you give them an ICD, and before they actually have an event. Secondary prevention is they already had a sudden cardiac arrest, but they survived it, and now you're treating after the fact. Okay? So there, the last major landmark trial on this was done in early 2000. This is settled science. It's no longer a debate. It's no longer a discussion as to whether or not this is beneficial to heart failure. It's settled. It's done. No one is paying for any more research except how to fine-tune programming, etc. Okay? And this is one of the landmark trials. I wanted to bring your attention to this, essentially the MADIT. You must have heard of this sometime, but it happened all the way back in 1996. And this is still quoted. And essentially what it showed is that ICDs reduce all-cause mortality by more than 50% in the implanted patients. So the, here it is that you have an intervention that changed life expectancy by more than 50%, all right? And of course there's follow-up studies to this that showed the MADIT2, which essentially was the first trial to show the life-saving benefits of ICDs without requiring patients to actually have an event before. So we talked about what is secondary prevention. You've all seen TV shows where patients are rushed into the emergency room, everybody says clear, zap, and they're alive, right? Well, think about this. When this actually happens in the real world, only 5% of patients make it to hospital. So our job is to identify the at-risk patients so they don't have to die before they reach hospital. Their lives can be saved before they reach hospital. This is an actual recording from an implantable device. You can see the squiggly rhythm. This is ventricular fibrillation. Here the device delivers a shock, boom, and they're back into paced rhythm, right? It's much more organized. So when it works, it actually works really well. So we like to illustrate cases. This is one of my cases as well, a 65-year-old cosmetologist. She's actually from Grenada, but works in Port of Spain. She got minimal exertion, shortness of breath on minimal exertion, leg swelling, the whole works of heart failure, and EF was 15%. This is the X-ray after implantation of a cardiac resynchronization with defibrillation. You can notice this is the generator or the box. We have three leads. This was in the right ventricle. There's one that comes around here through the coronary sinus, and then there is another one that curls up here in the right atrium. You could see it laterally. This is the one that goes in the coronary sinus. This is the ventricle, and this is the atrium. You notice the one in the ventricle is a little thicker. This is your shock coil, right? That's the high voltage equipment. That's the one that actually cost a lot of money. And in case you can't quite make it out on that, this is what it actually looks like in a simpler drawing. Device, one lead in the atrium, one lead in the ventricle, and one through the coronary sinus. This was her ECG before implant. Notice the wide QRS complex with a left bundle branch pattern. And this is the morning after. Notice the narrowing QRS, all right? 6 months later, her EF had doubled to now 30%. She walked 4 blocks to clinic about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. She had 3 episodes of painless therapy. So we know for sure that these are patients who benefit. Patients in NYHA class 3-4, already on medical therapy, low EF with widened QRS complex. And ICD therapy, is it effective? Absolutely. Look at it compared to medical therapy. The number needed to treat to save one life, essentially in single digit, whereas in medical therapy, everything else is above 20. So when you have your heart failure patient, the question is, would they benefit from device therapy? And these are the things you would look for. Previous VTVF, the NYHA class, the ejection fraction, patient with previous MI with non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, do they have a left bundle branch block? And if in doubt, you have many resources that you can look at. There are several experts in Jamaica right here that you can consult and know. And hopefully, you will get there before this happens.
Right. Thank you very much, Mahendra. That was a great talk. He condensed, I don't know what, 15 years of training into about 25 minutes. It was excellent. It was clear to me. But it was a very enjoyable talk. And we'll have to leave questions to the end, I'm afraid, because we're running low on time. So now we're going to move on to the second talk in the session, which is Heart Failure Causes in Diabetes Mellitus. And it's going to be delivered by Dr. Handel Emery, who is a general and nuclear cardiologist. He did his internal medicine degree here at the University of the West Indies, and in 2010, he gained his membership with the Royal College of Physicians of London, and shortly thereafter went to the University of Toronto, where he pursued fellowships in general cardiology, nuclear cardiology, and stress echo. He returned to Jamaica in 2014. He is a consultant cardiologist at the University Hospital of the West Indies and associate lecturer at UWE. He is a member of several professional bodies, including American College of Physicians, Royal College of Physicians of London, and the American Society of Nuclear Cardiology. And his special areas of interest are heart failure, cardiomyopathies, myocardial perfusion imaging, and echocardiography. Handel, please come and deliver your talk.
Okay, great. Good afternoon, all. So I have 2 strikes against me so far. One, I'm in the coveted postprandial slot, and secondly, I had to come after Dr. Carpen, who I feel like I've been following all for my entire medical career. He's a tough act to follow, as I told him earlier. But my thanks to the organizers for having invited me to speak, and my thanks to you for your attention as well. It's a pleasure to be here, and it's a pleasure to speak on a subject which is of great interest to me, and that is the issue of heart failure in the diabetic patient. This is an area which is of great interest to me for a number of reasons. One of them is shown here, and that is the sheer scope and size of the diabetic epidemic globally. As at 2013, it affected a whopping Okay, there we go. Approximately 400 million persons globally, and by recent statistics, it affects approximately 12% of the Jamaican population. So it is, by all stretches, by all definitions, a significant epidemic. But the second reason this topic interests me is because of the poor prognosis which is associated with heart failure. And many of us are well aware of some of these statistics already, and Dr. Carpen highlighted some of them for us as well. But we may well be aware that within 5 years, approximately 50% of women and about 60% of men who are given a diagnosis of heart failure will die within 5 years. Even those who are fortunate enough to survive oftentimes struggle with a number of illnesses or a number of recurrent complications such as arrhythmias, acute decompensated heart failure. They unfortunately have to undergo, in many cases, numerous medical procedures, and they are subjected to polypharmacy. So it's not an easy road by any stretch of the imagination. All of this, of course, translates into very high and very significant costs, as Dr. Carpen highlighted. And clearly, these costs can be burdensome and onerous to the fragile finances of many patients and their families, and certainly the fragile budgets of poor third world countries or developing countries like ours. So for all of these reasons, this particular potential nexus or link between diabetes and heart failure concerns me greatly, and I think should concern us all. So having said that, these are my areas of focus for the talk. So we will briefly review the history of the association between diabetes and heart failure. We will discuss the historical context in which this occurs. We'll discuss briefly the mechanisms. We'll focus to some degree on diabetic cardiomyopathy with regards to its pathogenesis evaluation and briefly touch on its management. Okay, so let's begin by placing this in its appropriate historical context. So the link between diabetes and heart failure was first suggested by this gentleman here, Ernest Victor von Leyden. He was a German professor of internal medicine who became somewhat famous for treating, I believe it was Tsar Nicholas II. But in any event, he accumulated quite a bit of clinical experience, and on the basis of this, he opined that heart failure was potentially a complication of diabetes. Now, of course, this was based on clinical experience, empirical data. He had no good epidemiologic data to support this assertion. However, it wouldn't take very long before such data would begin to emerge, and perhaps the most important of these epidemiologic studies was the Framingham Heart Study. This has become a landmark heart study which really has defined the relationship between a number of risk factors and the subsequent development of cardiovascular disease. The Framingham Heart Study was commenced in 1948, approximately 70 years after Victor von Leyden opined as he did. And it was undertaken in a town called Framingham, Massachusetts, a relatively small town, about 60,000 inhabitants, 5,000 of whom approximately were selected to undergo this particular study. It was a long-term prospective observational study. So what happened was that these subjects were studied at baseline. They had a baseline history, physical examination, lab work done at baseline, and they were brought back about every 2 years and again subjected to physical examination and laboratory testing. And this continued for approximately 30 years. So it was a very heterogeneous population at outset. And by virtue of this, it became possible to establish relationships or associations between particular risk factors and the ultimate development of cardiovascular disease. This, for example, is how we became aware, or should I say, solidified the relationship between the occurrence of hypertension, for example, and coronary artery disease or cerebrovascular disease or heart failure later on. More germane to this topic, though, is the fact that the Framingham Heart Study established an unequivocal link between the diagnosis of diabetes and the subsequent development of heart failure in later years. In fact, it showed that having diabetes increased the risk of heart failure dramatically. How dramatically? Men who were diabetic were twice as likely to develop heart failure in later years as their non-diabetic counterparts, and diabetic women were a whopping 5 times more likely to develop heart failure in their subsequent years relative to their non-diabetic counterparts. A number of smaller studies subsequently validated these findings. There are several of them. I'll just highlight two quickly. The cardiovascular health study, relatively smaller population, about 6,000 patients, but it showed that having diabetes doubled the risk of developing heart failure. And the strong heart study, roughly 1,200 subjects, in which it was shown that diabetes increased the risk of developing heart failure by a factor of about 1.5-fold. Further evidence, however, would emerge in the 1980s and 90s, and this came in the form now of large heart failure registries. So by then, drugs like the ACE inhibitors and the angiotensin receptor blockers had been discovered, and registries were now being compiled in order to investigate the prognostic value of these therapies in managing patients with heart failure. So many of us would know about the SOLVED Atlas, the VHEFT, and a number of other registries. Now, one of the striking things about these registries were significantly the by comparison to the prevalence of diabetes in the general population, the prevalence is about 4 to 8%, 12% according to the most recent local data. The prevalence of diabetes in these registries was a whopping 20-odd percent, so 26% in the SOLVE trial, 19% ATLAS, and 20% in VHEF. So there is clearly something, there's clearly an association between diabetes and hypertension, which needs to be, diabetes and heart failure, which needs to be explained. So this association seems to be strong, it is consistent, it is specific. So the obvious question, which I'm sure we're all asking, is what are the mechanisms which underpin this association? Perhaps the mechanism which is most well described, most well recognized, perhaps easiest to explain is this one, which posits that diabetes may cause heart failure by first causing accelerated atherosclerosis, and this is described here. So we know that diabetes induces a state of hyperglycemia, which results in the formation of advanced glycated end products, or AGE for short. This cross-links LDL cholesterol. Eventually you get the formation of foam cells as a result of the phagocytosis of this complex by macrophages, and ultimately you get the development of fatty streaks which coalesce to form fatty plaques. Over time, one gets the development of coronary artery disease, and subsequent to that, some persons will go on to developing ischemic cardiomyopathy and subsequently heart failure on the background of that. So this mechanism is very well understood, very easy to understand and to explain, and it is perhaps the predominant mechanism by which diabetics will go on to developing heart failure. There's a secondary mechanism which is highlighted here. According to the Jamaica Health and Lifestyle Study, the third iteration, I believe, the prevalence of hypertension in Jamaica is anywhere from 33%, if you go by the JNC7 criteria, to a whopping 58% by the new ACC/AHA criteria. And the prevalence of diabetes is about 12%. The bottom line, or the point, is that there is significant overlap between hypertension and diabetes in most populations. And it is believed that the persons, the diabetic persons who go on to developing heart failure may actually fall in that overlap group. So these may be patients who are going on to developing heart failure mainly on the background of their hypertension rather than on the by virtue of their diabetes per se. Now, for some time, these mechanisms were thought to be the principal mechanisms which underpin the relationship between diabetes and heart failure. However, in 1972, a third mechanism was described, and this was described on the background of a very small series of patients who had an ante-mortem history of long-standing diabetes and had classic signs and symptoms of heart failure. However, extensive workup, including post-mortem examination, did not reveal any obvious cause of heart failure in these patients. So these patients had no hypertension, therefore invalidating the second mechanism in them. They had no coronary artery disease, therefore the first mechanism, which I described, obviously was not operating in those patients. In addition to that, they had nothing else. They had no valvular problems. They had no congenital heart disease. They had no history of alcohol consumption, no thiamine deficiencies, no hormonal abnormalities, etc. So on the basis of this particular study, the authors, Rubler et al., opined that the metabolic milieu, the metabolic environment which was being induced in diabetics was potentially directly toxic to the cardiomyocytes, leading to the development of a cardiomyopathy and therefore the development of a diabetic, what is called a diabetic cardiomyopathy. So what therefore is a diabetic cardiomyopathy? It is defined as ventricular dysfunction, which occurs in diabetic patients, independent of any other cause, and in particular, independent of ischemic cardiomyopathy, as well as independent of hypertensive heart disease. It is felt to be one of three mechanisms by which diabetic patients go on to developing heart failure. The other two are indicated here, as we have already discussed. Okay, now, having identified the pathology, the question therefore becomes, what is the pathophysiology? And in this regard, one of our very own has been quite instrumental in helping us to understand the mechanisms which underpin a diabetic cardiomyopathy. And that is Professor, oops, I'm sorry about that. That is Professor Dale Abel. Let's go back. Whom, of course, is a graduate of the University of the West Indies and subsequently went on to Oxford University as a Rhodes Scholar and is currently Professor of Medicine, I believe, at the University of Salt Lake City. He was actually able to, he has become instrumental in elucidating a lot of these mechanisms, and he was able to do so by creating models of diabetes in rodents in some interesting ways. So he induced diabetes and others, induced type 1 diabetes in rodents by injecting toxic streptozotocin, which is toxic to the beta cells and therefore induces insulinopenia, or insulin deficiency rather, and therefore the development of diabetes type 2. He was able to induce, I'm sorry, that should be diabetes type 1. He was able to induce type 2 diabetes by breeding rats which lack the leptin receptor or leptin itself, and therefore they become morbidly obese, insulin resistant, and then diabetic. As a result of this, he and others were able to study the effect of diabetes and hyperglycemia and the other metabolic abnormalities which occur in diabetes on the myocardium of the rodents. The pathophysiology becomes quite complex, but I have it summarized here. So diabetes may induce or often induces hyperglycemia, which results in the formation of reactive oxygen species, and this contributes to the development of what is called glucotoxicity, as well as also contributes to fibrosis and mitochondrial dysfunction. In addition to that, there is increased formation of free fatty acids and triglycerides, which by means of a toxic metabolite called ceramide induces lipotoxicity. All of these mechanisms, glucotoxicity, fibrosis, mitochondrial dysfunction, impairment in calcium homeostasis, which we haven't discussed, and lipotoxicity contribute to the development of cardiac dysfunction and ultimately to diabetic cardiomyopathy. So the issue of a diabetic cardiomyopathy is therefore no longer one which is really controversial or in doubt, and a number of professional bodies have now recognize this. This is one example. This is a statement from the American College of Cardiology Foundation and the AHA Task Force 2013, which stated that diabetes mellitus is now recognized as a risk factor for the development of heart failure independent of age, hypertension, obesity, hypercholesterolemia, and coronary artery disease. Not only have they moved to recognize it, but a number of others have actually established formal criteria for its diagnosis. This is one of the best ones. This is the ESC, European Society of Cardiology Diagnostic Criteria for this particular condition, which was published in 2015. This recognizes two different categories, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, so-called HEF-PEF, and then HEF-REF, and the diagnostic criteria are shown here. So the presence of diabetes, the exclusion of coronary artery disease, valvular and congenital heart disease, exclusion of hypertensive heart disease, and exclusion of infiltrative cardiac disorders by means of endomyocardial biopsy. Now, this clearly is currently not available locally. Therefore, we're forced to make the diagnosis by using the other parameters highlighted here. The criteria are somewhat similar here. The difference between the two clearly is the ejection fraction. Here, the ejection fraction is less than 50%. This is preserved ejection fraction. Heart failure, LVEF less than 50% in patients with HEF-REF. Okay, so we are for the most part clinicians, and so whilst the basic sciences may be somewhat interesting, at the end of the day, we really are more interested in how does this translate into what we do on a day-to-day basis in our clinics or with our hospitalized patients, etc. The key point here really is that heart failure in the diabetic patient is managed in a similar way to heart failure in the non-diabetic patient. So clearly it begins with a history and examination and appropriate investigations, blood work, the electrocardiogram, echocardiogram, and ischemia testing. The echocardiogram is particularly important in these patients, particularly in the early stages, because all these patients may have initially is diastolic dysfunction, and echo, particularly Doppler techniques, are very sensitive in diagnosing diastolic dysfunction at an early stage. Of course, ischemia testing is important. Coronary angiography is important for the exclusion of coronary artery disease, epicardial coronary artery disease, as well as allows assessment of hemodynamics, a number of hemodynamic parameters which are of value to us in the cardiology world. Now, having evaluated the patient, the diabetic patient who is in heart failure, how do you manage such a patient? And the principles of management really crystallize around three important concepts. One is lifestyle modification, secondly, managing hyperglycemia, and thirdly, managing the patient's heart failure. A discussion on lifestyle modifications perhaps beyond the scope of our talk today, but in summary, diet, exercise, stop smoking, maintain a healthy weight. I think we already know most of this. As it relates to managing hyperglycemia, now this is an area which is continues to be one of some controversy, particularly in relation to glycemic targets. However, current guidelines suggest that in patients with type 1 diabetes, it is reasonable to target tight glycemic control, and that means aiming for an HbA1c of between 6 and 7, and this is on the basis of two major trials, the DCCT and the DCCT/EDIC trials, which show reduced microvascular and macrovascular complications in patients who had tight glycemic control. This is in type 1 diabetics. In type 2 diabetics, on the basis of the UK PDS, which showed a reduced frequency of microvascular complications, but increased all-cause mortality, as shown in their CORD trial, it is reasonable in such patients to avoid tight glycemic control and to aim for an HbA1c of between 7 and 7.9, as was done in the CORD trial. Okay, now, having so investigated the patient, we may at some point want to initiate some form of therapy. What therapies are recommended, which ones are not? Metformin is still considered the first line therapy in most patients. However, it should be used with caution, and that is because there is a slightly increased risk of developing lactic acidosis. This is particularly the case in persons with advanced heart failure. Notwithstanding that, most of us, I think, still use metformin as first line in most of our diabetic patients who have heart failure. The thiazolidine diones are not recommended, and this is because they, of course, induce fluid retention, and this can be resistant to diuretics, so they should not be used. All other agents are pretty much fair game and can be used safely. Brief mention here of the SGLT2 inhibitors, which have recently been quite topical. There's a lot of interest in the use of these drugs in diabetic heart failure patients, and that is on the background of a number of important studies which have recently been published. There is certainly a reduced frequency of major adverse cardiac events in persons with overt cardiovascular disease. And so it is a reasonable option to use these in the appropriate patient. It should be noted, however, that these are fairly modest in terms of their ability to reduce the HbA1c. So efficacy, hypoglycemic efficacy is fairly limited, but there is significant prognostic benefit associated with their use. So beyond that, managing the patient's heart failure really is similar to managing heart failure in any other patient. That means that if the patient has got diastolic dysfunction, then you focus on diuresis and fluid restriction and treating any underlying cause which you can identify. In patients who have systolic dysfunction, you do all of that, plus you start a number of drugs which have been shown to confer a prognostic benefit. These include ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, spironolactone, and of course, the new kid on the block, which is many of us know, is sacubitril valsartan, the PARADIGM heart failure trial. Advanced heart failure therapies are appropriate for some of these patients. Some may say most of them. Dr. Carpen spoke about LVADs. Certainly these are appropriate in diabetic patients. Intra-aortic balloon pumps. Heart transplantation used to be, diabetes used to be seen as a relative contraindication for heart transplantation. It is no longer regarded to be, and therefore in appropriate patients it should be considered. Of course, this does require some jumping through some hoops in order to have that happen, but it should not be excluded in the appropriate patient. Okay, and I think this is my last slide. So, in summary, diabetes is a major cause of heart failure. The mechanisms which underpin this association include accelerated atherosclerosis, the overlap between hypertension and diabetes. The pathogenesis of diabetic cardiomyopathy is complex but includes a number of mechanisms, including glucotoxicity, lipotoxicity, mitochondrial dysfunction, culminating in the development of either diastolic dysfunction or systolic dysfunction. The diagnosis rests on clinical and laboratory workup, including echo and ischemia testing when and where appropriate. And the management of heart failure in diabetics should involve lifestyle modification, control of hyperglycemia, and management of their heart failure. And I believe that is my last slide.
Thank you, Handel. That was, again, very well condensed and very comprehensive. Again, we are out of time, so we're going to move on to our third talk in the session, which is entitled Sudden Cardiac Death, and it's going to be presented by Dr. Marilyn Lawrence-Wright. And Marilyn is Jamaican, but she did her MD, you did your undergrad at medical school at Brown, and cardiology at Johns Hopkins. She is practicing full-time in Jamaica, and she is consultant cardiologist at the University Hospital of the West Indies and chief of the cardiology division in the Department of Medicine. So she keeps all of us in line. She also works at the Heart Foundation of Jamaica and is involved in many of its outreach projects. Marilyn, let me invite you to come and talk on sudden cardiac death.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much, Dr. Chung, for that kind introduction. I'm very much a mentor of mine, and in terms of keeping in check, wouldn't really call it that, but anyway. Thank you very much to UDOP for inviting me to present this afternoon. I'll be presenting on sudden cardiac death, certainly a topic that should be of interest to us all. I have no disclosures. We're going to define sudden cardiac death, discuss a bit of its epidemiology, causes, pathophysiology, how we go about restratifying patients, preventing sudden cardiac death if we can. We'll discuss some specific syndromes that can increase the risk of sudden cardiac death, and then I'll make some concluding remarks. So, the death card. Not really so much like the one that we use here, but similar, and you'll see immediate cause of death here, cardiopulmonary arrest. Very often when we're filling out our death cards, we wouldn't really put that, because that's a mode of death. We'd usually more list a cause of death. But the point here is that most patients will exit by cardiopulmonary arrest, okay? And so it happens every day, and we need to see what we can do to prevent it. So what is death? It's a moment at which life ends. It's a time at which biological functions that sustain a living organism cease. What's of interest, however, is that conditions that were previously considered to be indicative of death are now reversible. Okay, so we now think of death not so much as an event, but as a process. We have physiologic death, we have clinical death, absence of breathing and pulse, we have brain death, and we have legal death, where a patient who is brain dead can be pronounced legally dead, and requires a statement of death by a licensed medical practitioner. And in terms of the signs, you will often talk about no breathing, absence of pulse, but following that you have pallor mortis, liver mortis, algor mortis, not really going to stay too much on this, followed by rigor mortis, and then finally decomposition. So it is a process, and if we can stop the process early, then we can say death may actually be reversible. All right, so what is sudden cardiac death? Sudden cardiac death is death resulting from an abrupt loss of cardiac function. The time and the mode of death are unexpected, and it usually occurs within minutes of the symptoms appearing. It's also been defined as death from probable or definite cardiac cause within 1 hour of symptom onset. Now that 1 hour is important because the death, for it to be classified as a sudden cardiac death, must occur within 1 hour of symptom onset. It has been estimated that it claims approximately, well, more than 7 million lives per year worldwide. And in terms of the incidence, 1 to 300,000 for those younger than 35 years. And in those in the 35 to 64 year age group, the estimate is that worldwide the incidence is 10 to 75 in every 100,000. So the risk does increase, or the incidence does increase with age. It has been found to be more highly prevalent in men or among males. It accounts for 50% of all cardiac deaths and nearly 20% of all deaths in the developed world. Acute ventricular tachyarrhythmia is the most common cause of sudden cardiac death. I don't have any Jamaican statistics, and these are some statistics from the United States that are a little bit dated, 2008, but it does occur in children as well. You'll see the rate here, 55 per 100,000 among US adults back in 2008, and 2.6 to 19.7 among the children. Note also that high school athletes have been separated here because we do have an increased incidence among competitive athletes. In terms of survival, survival to discharge from hospital, patients who arrest in hospital have a higher survival rate than those who arrest outside the hospital. And do note here that if you look at the adults on the left and the children on the right, according to these statistics from the American Heart Association, the survival for those who had arrested in hospital was 27% for children compared to 18% for adults. Okay, not sure how much you can, you know, read this graphic, but the point here is speaking a bit in terms of the further about the epidemiology of sudden cardiac death. And the point is that on the left, we have the incidence of sudden death according to different groups. On the right, we have the number of sudden deaths per year among those groups. So going from top to bottom, we have the general population. We have patients with a high coronary risk profile, so diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, tobacco use, obesity, sedentary lifestyle. Following this, we have patients who have had a previous coronary event, followed by patients with an ejection fraction less than 35% or who have congestive heart failure. Then patients with a previous out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. And then finally, patients with previous myocardial infarction, low ejection fraction, and a known history or documented history of ventricular tachycardia. Okay, so in terms of the incidence on the left, you can see as you go, you know, to the higher risk patient, there's an increased incidence. If you're talking about the number of events that happen, you can see that the number of events are much higher in the general population. Okay, so the point is that when we're defining risk, if we define it too narrowly, we may identify selected patients who, yes, are at higher risk and we can intervene on, but these interventions are not going to have that much benefit in terms of the entire society. Okay, and most of the deaths are happening in the general population among patients who are not necessarily identified as being at the highest risk of sudden cardiac death. All right, so this graphic basically shows, you know, prevalence of diabetes worldwide. We've seen something similar to this quite a bit. And of course, diabetes is very prevalent, as is heart disease. Okay, heart disease shown in the pink. And in terms of the relationship, Dr. Emery went through quite a bit in terms of some of the pathogenetic and pathophysiological of the link, but in terms of some of the numbers, patients with diabetes have a 2 to 3 times increased risk of heart disease. They account in the United States for 280,000 heart attacks annually, and the morbidity and mortality rates are 2 to 4 times higher than those patients who do not have diabetes. Okay, and a patient with diabetes, the final one with the X on the right, has a 60% chance of dying from heart disease. Okay, so very important in terms of when we're thinking about our patients with diabetes. Why? Many patients with diabetes have metabolic derangement for up to 4 to 7 years before formal diagnosis. Because of diabetes affecting the neurological system, often symptoms are atypical or maybe absent, giving rise to delayed presentation. And even when the patients present, there is delayed diagnosis in many cases. Patients with diabetes, as Dr. Emery had alluded to or had stated, often have other cardiovascular risk factors. Okay, there's hypertension, dyslipidemia, obesity, and as many as 20% of patients with diabetes will have other cardiovascular risk factors at the time of the diabetes diagnosis. Just going to put through all of these. This just shows some of the way that cardiovascular disease presents in patients with diabetes. Really, I would have loved to highlight it at the very end, sudden death in the purple at the top, because sudden death is one of the manifestations of cardiovascular disease in the patient with diabetes. All right, so in terms of identifying the at-risk patient, look at point number one. Okay, as many as 45% of persons who have sudden cardiac death were seen by a physician within the 4 weeks prior to the episode. Okay, as many as 75% of the complaints at that time were not related to the cardiovascular system. Okay, but they had been seen by a physician within the previous month. Some patients, the risk may be identified because of a history of coronary artery disease, or they may have had a personal history of death, sudden cardiac death, or they may have a family history of syncope, left ventricular ejection fraction of less than 35%. These patients are easier to identify. However, right, many of the patients are not going to present initially with cardiac complaints. So we need to have a keen eye, ask particular questions, because they may not complain, but if we, you know, take the history sufficiently, we may be able to tease out symptoms that may be prognostic in terms of identifying a patient who's at higher risk of sudden cardiac death. Previous cardiac arrest, syncope, prior MI, reduced ejection fraction. If there's a history of frequent ventricular ectopy, usually more than 10 PVCs per hour, or if the patient has a history of non-sustained ventricular tachycardia, that may have been picked up on a Holter, that may have been done for palpitations, may have been done for pre-syncope or syncope. In terms of symptoms, they may have had sudden collapse with a prodrome or without. If there's no prodrome, it's usually primary ventricular fibrillation. Patient who's having a myocardial infarction may complain of chest pain or shortness of breath, may be just generally unwell, may feel nausea, may have vomited, just dizzy. And the symptoms may have been lasting for a few minutes or may have been going on intermittently for several hours. In terms of the arrhythmia, as I had said, ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation is often the exit rhythm, and tachyarrhythmias will account for about 83.4% in this, according to this data published in 89 by Bayes de Luna, with VTAC, ventricular tachycardia, accounting for 62.4%, torsades de pointe for 12.7%, and primary ventricular fibrillation for 8.3%. Okay, patients who had bradyarrhythmia or asystole as their primary rhythm, they accounted for 16.6% of this cohort. In terms of what will trigger, particularly a ventricular arrhythmia, acute ischemia, particularly in the presence of a prior infarct, there may be neurohormonal disturbances, electrolyte imbalance, acid-base disturbance, there may be hypoxia or hypercapnia, or it may be some medication that has some proarrhythmic effect. Most commonly, it's ventricular tachycardia, going to ventricular fibrillation, going to asystole. Okay, but patients who have advanced heart disease may present initially with a bradyarrhythmia or pulseless electrical activity. There are some N-channel abnormalities, long QT syndrome, that can increase your risk of these arrhythmias. If you have Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome and have rapid atrial fibrillation, that can progress to ventricular fibrillation and sudden cardiac death. Conditions that initiate and maintain these arrhythmias can be transient, can happen when you're healing from myocardial injury. The mechanisms, I think Dr. Carpen would have mentioned some of these in terms of re-entry, increased automaticity, triggered activity, or some combination of the others. But the fact is that there is some abnormal rhythm that then goes to asystole. We discussed ischemia, but it may also be that there's a scar or even simple hypertrophy of the myocardium, particularly if there is disarray of the myocardial cells, as in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, that will be a substrate that's at increased risk of having sudden cardiac death. And then sometimes there are some primary electrophysiological abnormalities that increase the risk. You're not going to be able to read this, but this basically speaks to a bit of these risk factors. And when you're trying to stratify the patient, you know, you go whether or not the patient has coronary risk factors, high cholesterol, hypertension, diabetes, tobacco use, whether they have heart failure, and if they do, what is their New York Heart Association class, whether there has been any documentation of prior arrhythmias, particularly ventricular arrhythmias or ventricular ectopics, what does the ECG look like? Is there evidence of left ventricular hypertrophy? What is a QT interval? These are things that can be assessed to try to, you know, see who may be at increased risk. And then there's formal electrophysiological testing that can further risk stratify these patients. In terms of some specific syndromes, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, long QT, obstructive sleep apnea, increasingly prevalent. We'll just look a little bit at young athletes, because that, you know, definitely has been a problem, and then Brugado right ventricular dysplasia. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, genetic autosomal dominant, can be familial or there can be sporadic cases. There's a missense mutation in one of at least 10 sarcomere protein genes. It affects patients of all age and the clinical features are diverse. This just shows, you know, the proteins and the genes of at least one of these is affected in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. This graphic on the left shows a patient, the echo, a still echo image of a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and I think you can appreciate the very thickened interventricular septum. Once that septum gets to over 2 centimeters, very increased risk of sudden cardiac death. You know, often it's familial, so you have screening for the patient, but you also have screening for family members. I usually recommend 2D echocardiography on all first-degree family members every 5 years, with screening beginning with annual screening for patients who are presenting in their adolescent years. So, for patients who are presented in their adolescent years, annual screening of their family members. This graphic just really shows that in terms of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, we have the heart failure side of things, the structural, the obstruction, but you also have just the pure electrophysiological sudden death risk that we try to treat with either amiodarone therapy or more often an implantable cardioverter defibrillator. In terms of long QT syndrome, again, genetic, several variants. Often it's torsades the point that's happening. In terms of other things here, we have a picture on the left of a patient with arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. This is an MRI image, and if you look to the left, that white patch there with the RV, that's the fatty infiltration of the RV wall. Here, just mentioning the WPW, looking for the short PR, the delta wave. You're probably not going to properly be able to appreciate that, but if you... Here, you can see there's a slight upslur on the QRS complex. That would be the delta wave, and the PR interval will be less than 120 milliseconds. Congenital long QT here, a long QT interval. And then Brugada syndrome, you have this upward and slurring in V1, okay, with a coved kind of downsloping ST elevation in V1 to V4. You can have anomalous coronary arteries. You can have a myocarditis. The patient would have had a recent viral illness that can, you know, cause them to have a dilated cardiomyopathy. With a decreased cardiac dysfunction, with increased cardiac dysfunction, these patients become at increased risk of sudden cardiac death. In terms of arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, you may see these find, you know, some findings in terms of inverted T waves in the right precordial leads on ECG. You may see a poorly contractile RV on echo, but really we're looking for the fatty fibrous replacement of the RV myocytes on MRI. Okay, obstructive sleep apnea, increasingly prevalent, right? So repeated nocturnal episodes of acute apnea, hypoxemia, hypercapnia. We know the increased risk of atrial fibrillation. However, it's associated with hypercoagulability, increased oxidative stress, and inflammation. And so this can also increase the risk of sudden cardiac death. Okay, finally, the young face of sudden cardiac death. We know it's prevalent. We know it happens in older patients with coronary artery disease, patients with diabetes. What about the young patient who doesn't seem to have any of these risk factors? Right, this slide actually has an error because it's actually Kamoy Campbell, right? Not Bailey. Well-known Olympian who recently collapsed back in February. And here he is, and here is the emergency management team responding. He survived, right, but these others, right, not too long ago, Kavan McKenzie, Kavan Carter, Matthew Hilton, they were not able to survive. Exercise is good, yes, but it does, it can predispose a patient who has quiescent cardiovascular abnormalities to sudden cardiac death if there is exercise-induced catecholamine surge, dehydration, hyperpyrexia, electrolyte imbalance. These can precipitate sudden cardiac death. This just speaks a bit about some of the abnormalities that have been found to be increased among athletes, and some of the things that we may want to look for in terms of screening our athletes for their risk. An athlete may have blunt trauma force, which can increase the risk of sudden cardiac death, and some of our athletes, unfortunately, are using performance-enhancing drugs, which can also increase the risk of sudden cardiac death. So in terms of sudden cardiac death, it's reversible if caught early. If you look at the very bottom of the slide, you'll see sinus rhythm, degenerating to ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, and then asystole. Only 20% of those who have an out-of-hospital arrest will survive, but these are some factors that can, help to identify those who are more likely to make it out of the hospital. Anoxic encephalopathy, however, does occur in many of our arrest survivors, and it speaks to our need to really be aggressive with our response to this emergency. Yes, we may have primary preventive efforts with beta blockade, can be helpful in some patients. We may try amiodarone therapy. We may implant an automated implantable defibrillator. However, for the patients who have not necessarily been previously identified, and for all patients indeed, what's important is a very strong and well-organized emergency response system with early access to care, early CPR, early defibrillation is most important, followed by early advanced care and good post-care. Here we see, immediate, but this is actually CPR training. Important for bystanders to know basic CPR, and then, for those of us who can go on to ACLS to know that. Also important, defibrillation. Okay, we now have automated external defibrillators, which really are easy to use. The machine tells you what to do. They are expensive, but early defibrillation does help to save lives. So in summary, sudden cardiac death is real. It's here. It claims more than 7 million lives per year worldwide. Coronary artery disease and atheroma, thrombus, is the most common cause in those who are older, and as such, we must think about it in our patients with diabetes. They do have cardiovascular disease. And certainly with those with coronary artery disease, ventricular tachyarrhythmias are the most frequent cause of death, and in many patients it is, but you may have a few with a bradyarrhythmia. And very often in those patients, it could either be acute ischemia, or they may have an underlying substrate that has been triggered somewhat by some intervening event. Because it can happen to any of us, any of our patients, it's important to discuss end-of-life issues, okay, before we come to this juncture, and to discuss resuscitation status with our patients and among ourselves and with our family members. Once again, a well-trained, adequately equipped emergency response team is very important and can help to save a life. In conclusion, don't know what you think about this quote, but death is, after all, inevitable. Only unexpected death or sudden death is the enemy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marilyn. Ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the close of the 10th scientific session. I'm afraid we're out of time. What can I say? Cardiologists just like to talk. You'll soon hear some more. In any event, I yield to the next chair. Thank you.